This is the Perceiver of Sound Lake. This is the first installment of what looks like it's going to become a series of improvised music, third Saturday of every month. And we're excited to have Sanders Davis and his quartet being the featured act for the first performance. But before this, I just wanted to say a couple things about improvised music and why, like, we would have a series of improvised music. You know, I was talking to a really good musician the other day who I know is a good improviser, and asking her if maybe she'd be interested in playing. And she said, what, like, no songs or anything like that? I do that at home, but why would I do that in public? You know, and I guess so part of the idea is, you know, is not so much, it's not a rejection or a repudiation of the idea of composition, but it's sort of a whole different thing, and it's a whole different kind of way of playing and listening, where, you know, I guess in a way we're trained in school and in the discipline of learning music or whatever discipline we engage in to exert critical judgment and to be connoisseurs in a sense to say, well, I want to, you know, listen to this and examine whether it's done correctly or done incorrectly, and then like it or not like it according to this judgment of whether it's done correctly or incorrectly. Whereas I think the mindset of the improviser has more to do with a non-judgmental frame of mind, like the sensibility of, take you on a journey to the other side of the world in China, where they have a much different idea of what time is. The famous divinatory work, the I Ching, in China, is basically keyed on the idea that that time has different qualities. Like at different moments, time might have this quality or that quality, and they break it down into 64 different, you know, this into a spectrum of 64 different qualities that any given moment might have. And whereas we usually tune into our visual sense primarily and our audio sense secondarily, the visual sense has, oh, come, hey, Sarah Jane, and hey, Jack. The visual sense is extremely acute in terms of small distinctions of space, and is not very good at distinguishing very small subdivisions of time. Whereas the audio sense is the opposite. You can't make any real distinctions of spatiality. Well, you can tell if the sound's coming vaguely from over here or over there. But it's incredibly acute in terms of distinguishing time. Like, you can tell the difference between, you know, tens of a thousandth of a second. Distinctions that we make in terms of rhythm and pitch and whether two sounds come in simultaneously are extremely precise, like to 44,000 kilohertz, for example, is the sampling rate that they use in a lot of audio technology, which means that's as high a resolution as you get. And you can really tell differences of that small order of magnitude for sound. And so when you tune into an improvised piece, it's more like you're listening through a silence that is not inert, that there's the location in which it's taking place, the time at which the improvisation is taking place, are all integral parts of what's going on. So it's not like this improvisation can be abstracted and played some other time. This particular piece of music that you're going to be hearing from these musicians is intimately wedded to this place and this particular moment in time. It can never be recreated, and that's part of what's interesting about it. And another part of what's interesting about that is that perhaps it reveals something specific about this moment that, in its specificity, is not meant to be recreated. That there's something, you know, about So in other words, like you could go hear Beethoven's Ninth Symphony at any given time or place, but each time or place that you see it, it's going to have its own flavor, its own taste. In any composed piece of music that's played, there's a certain element of improvisation that comes into it. But when you see music that's entirely improvised, then it's almost like that quality of specificity to time, place, and to the people who are here is isolated and purified and made into the essence of the music. So that's what we're going to be getting a chance to hear today from these people. Sanders Davis and the CHAKRAS. Thank you.
Thank you.
foundation there, and kind of be just moving up through the scale, through the kind of keys, you know, because it all relates to colors, and everything you kind of perceive is divided in these different ways. So, yeah, we'll just keep on moving up through there, so that's kind of the foundation.
Oh, switch it up a little bit, you know, something different. And we like to, you know, like to keep it interesting, right?
Take everything, anything.
All right, I guess the fun toys on there. Well, in case you didn't know, I guess you heard I'm Sanders Davis, or Davis Sanders, depending on who you talk to. But, this is
or what publications you read.
Yes, this is Seth Oldham. Capacities and different projects. This is Noah Clark. Mr. Adam Collis. Wow.
Thank you.
we want. That's the idea.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
with when you're playing with improvisation like this is just the idea of repetition. And I've seen a lot of people get really interesting results with that. That's kind of one of those examples. Because if you just stick on something like that, no one has any idea how long it's going to go. And you can just take that and build that suspense. And, you know what happens. I actually saw somebody at there, this bass player, from years back when I was at UNCG, named Gray Hackleman. He did his senior recital. And at the end of one of his songs, they gave him a free-form solo. And he sat there and did just a... that same note over and over again. He did it like 35 times in an auditorium full of people who had no idea what was going to happen. And no one forgot that particular performance. Yeah. You could play the best, most intricate jazz solo in the world, but it would not have had the same impact of just hitting those same notes and letting everybody sit with the realization that they had no idea what was going to happen.
Just like life.
I just like life. Yes. Let's do this.
Thank you. Thank you.
appreciation.
Thank you.
Vibrationally, and now we have made the full circle. Get right back to that close spot there. It's amazing how many, how much those ratios that are present in music are present everywhere else, as far as the way that things are set up vibrationally, just throughout the color spectrum, vibration through your body, and the way it resonates with different things, your whole energetic system. You heard about the chakras and the meridians and all those things. It's set up that same way as well. So it's nice kind of playing with those ratios and seeing how you can manifest them in different ways, be it like composition or a written work or even visual art. So those things all tie together. It really, it's still surprising sometimes, even if you know that it's present in there.